Napoleon Hill said, "The world will make room for the man whose words and actions show that he knows where he is going." Have you ever been so intent on doing something that people just got out of your way and they let you go? Yeah, and they were probably pretty impressed about you because you were actually taking charge. That leads into goal setting. How to use goals to get what you desire. A couple of weeks after I wrote Sports Illustrated asking them where you go learn how to luge, they sent me an 8x10 picture of a guy racing on a luge. As soon as I got the picture, I framed it and hung it up in my room right in front of my bed. Every morning, the first person I saw when I woke up was the luge man. Seeing the luge man was like a constant reminder that I was training for the Olympics. He reminded me to eat right, to work out, and to surround myself with winners. At night, before turning out the lights, the last person I saw was the luge man. All night long, I dreamt about the luge and the Olympics. See, during the day, the picture focused my conscious mind on the dream. At night, it conditioned my unconscious mind to aim for my goal. It's important to keep reminders of your goals in front of you all the time. The walls of my office are completely covered with Olympic memorabilia, posters, awards, medals, and pictures of luge tracks. All of them are reminders of my dream and mind builders towards my goal. By doing this, my mind is constantly bombarded with my dream, competing in the Winter Olympic Games. No matter where I look, I'm constantly reminded of where I'm headed, where I want to go. If I daydream, I daydream about the Olympics. I always carry tapes with Olympic music in my car. I actually listen to a tape of the Salt Lake City opening ceremonies on the way to the gym to get myself all fired up. I do. In order to make big goals possible, many things have to happen simultaneously. Therefore, you can't afford to rely on chance. You have to start doing everything humanly possible to make the different factors happen, to orchestrate events, to put yourself in a position to win. For example, to get to the Olympics, I had to set financial goals, I had to set conditioning goals, I had to set technical training goals and organizational goals. Back in 1984, reaching my financial goal was pretty simple. The length of my luge season was determined by how much money I had saved all year long. And so as soon as I ran out of money, it was time to go home. At the time, I was still living at home with my parents, so my expenses were minimal. Not having any sponsors, I had to save every penny I made. So back then, when I went on a date, we didn't even go to the dollar movie. We waited till Tuesday night when it was 50 cents. But it didn't matter. It didn't feel like a sacrifice. I was just focusing on my dream. Conditioning goals. Conditioning goals were also fairly simple. I would simply follow my coach's advice. Like most Olympic athletes, I worked out on my own. I couldn't afford personal trainers. And thanks to my coaches, I had a plan. And I provided the willingness to follow it. As far as my technical goals, learning the technical aspects of luge and how to drive the different tracks, well, that was pretty simple too. You know, I just listened to the coach. I mean, it was simple, but it wasn't easy. You know, I just followed the lead of I humbled myself through the leadership of my coaches. And that's what you need to do too. Find somebody that's done what you're trying to do and swallow your pride and humble yourself through their leadership. And they will get you there so much quicker. The technical success depended on listening to the coaches. I mean, we would break down the track into sections. We would break down the sections down to curves. And then finally, we would learn exactly how to steer each section of every curve. And then, just like airline pilots, we were required to know what to do if something went wrong. For example, if you enter a curve a little too late, you need to immediately make a correction or else you could crash a couple of curves later. Over a period of years, we slowly developed a feel, a feeling, a familiarity with our space, right, as we came down the track. And the most experienced lugers have developed their feel so much that they're able to slide blindly with their heads tucked back in order to be that much more aerodynamic. It was challenging to feel to meet my financial requirements, my conditioning goals, and my luge technique goals. But by taking full responsibility, by deciding that it was up to me, if it was to be, it was up to me, I had to take full responsibility. By doing that, I had full control. See, when you decide to take responsibility, you get control. If you don't take responsibility, you lose control. I only had myself to blame if I didn't produce. And that's what you want to do. Unfortunately, there was one piece of the puzzle that was not under my control. one piece where I had to do everything I could on faith and then pray that everything would work out. In order to even have a chance to qualify for the Olympics, I had to start racing internationally by the end of my second season. Even if you qualify for a World Cup race, they won't let you race unless your country has a national luge federation that is recognized by its Olympic committee and it's also recognized by the International Luge Federation. See, so you got to have that going. Well, I was pioneering the sport of luge for Argentina. Obviously, Argentina didn't have a luge federation. So if I wanted to race internationally, it was going to be up to me to create an Argentine luge federation, and I was going to have to do it from Houston. Imagine that. Here I was, just learning the sport, and I had to convince the Argentines that in just 4 years, I would be good enough to qualify for the Olympics. I mean, is that realistic? Mustering the belief that I could convince them was the toughest hurdle I had to face on the way to the Olympics. It was a huge mental hurdle because the chances of it actually happening were so remote that it almost made no sense to even go for it. If my desire to become an Olympian had not been so great, I wouldn't have gone for it. But I wanted it so bad that I figured, hey, if I don't give it all I have, I'll only regret it later. I couldn't live with that regret. And so once that decision was made, I just set a goal to do everything in my power to make it happen. And so for 2 years, as I was learning how to luge, my dad and I wrote countless letters to the Argentine Olympic Committee asking them to form a luge federation. We wrote a lot of letters, a lot of letters. I have a 3-inch thick, 3-ring binder filled with copies of the letters. That's how many letters we wrote. And we didn't just hit them with quantity, we hit them with quality. Our letters were not filled with fluff. They were filled with all kinds of data and graphs that showed my progress. Since I had no personal credibility, since I was just starting with the sport, I decided I had to use the best credibility in the world. I asked the U.S. Olympic luge team coaches to write letters for me and to include progress reports on how my training was going. See, the Argentines would have been nuts to listen to me, but they couldn't ignore the U.S. Olympic luge team coaches, see? And so that's what you want to do too. Use testimonials. If you have a business that you're growing, get testimonials from your satisfied clients because people will believe your clients more than they'll believe you. If you go to my website, you'll notice that it's covered with testimonials. I've been blessed. I've been fortunate enough to get testimonials from people like Stephen Covey and Ken Blanchard and Rudy Rudiger, and to mention a few, and Jack Canfield and Mark Victor Hansen. But those things didn't just happen. I went out and I asked them. I spent months sending them stuff that I was doing, showing them what I was doing, in order to earn those testimonials. And you want to do the same thing. Testimonials are huge. Well, I was committed. I was committed to do whatever it took to get the Argentines to form a federation. And God honors commitment. He does. And so just like clockwork, a couple of weeks before the deadline, the Argentine Olympic Committee decided to create a luge federation. And the International Luge Federation gave their approval, and I was on my way. And so the next time you're dealing with a big goal, do what I did. Break it down into manageable chunks. In so doing, you'll see those challenges in a different light, which can help you muster up the courage, the gumption to take action. See, inch by inch, life's a cinch. Yard by yard, it's hard. So don't focus on what you have to do for the next 4 years. Focus on what can I do in the next 15 minutes to make that dream come true. At the Olympic Training Center, we are taught about the importance of writing down our goals every day. Magic happens when you write down your goals. Writing out your goals is an act that shows commitment. And so when you write down your goals, you're actually writing the script of the story of your future. You are. The coaches taught us to take a 3x5 card and write our goals down in a certain specific way. On one side of the card, we had to write our goal in the present tense. So write the goal in your present tense as if the goal is already happening. On the other side, write 3 things that you're doing every day to make your goal a reality. And so my card said, it's February 2002. I'm walking into the opening ceremonies of the Salt Lake City Winter Olympics. I'm a 3-time Olympian. The back side of the card said, I'm a 3-time Olympian because I work out every day, I eat right, I hang around winners, and I'm willing to do whatever it takes. See? There's 4 things on the back of my goal card. Well, I wanted to have a spare tire just in case. The front side of the card reminds you where you're going. The back side fuels your belief because your subconscious starts thinking, hey, I'm doing all the work. Therefore, it's only a matter of time before my goal becomes a reality. It just starts believing it. It believes that you deserve it, and you want to feel like you deserve it. Some people will tell you to put the card in your wallet, carry it with you wherever you go, and to pull it out and read it 5 times a day. I say don't do that. If you put your card in your wallet, next time you see it, it's going to be 5 years from now when you get a new wallet. Don't carry it in your wallet. Instead, take the card to the mirror in your bathroom right where you brush your teeth. Read the goals first thing in the morning and last thing at night. Best time to read your goals is when you're half asleep. Your mind is more receptive to picking up that information. Your mind is easily conditioned when you're half asleep. Read them with passion. Read them like you're mad. As you read your goals, look at yourself in the mirror. Lock into your eyeballs. That's how you read your goals when you're serious about them. Don't get wishy-washy now. Read them like you mean it. Goal setting works because it gives you direction. Goals remind you of where you're going. They give your life focus and they keep you from wasting your time. As soon as you set a goal, your mind starts trying to figure out a way to reach that goal. People that don't set goals are aimless wanderers. They are. They're usually bored, and they're not nearly as happy as people who have a clear, defined purpose. When life seems to be lacking purpose, many people fill their lives with diversions to distract them from that gnawing ache of emptiness in their gut. When you're not doing what you know you should be doing, you start feeling this gnawing ache in your heart. And they start filling their days with diversions like watching too much TV or spending too much time aimlessly surfing the net or drinking too much. Those are simply modern anesthesia to dull the pain. Yeah. If they would just get honest with themselves, search deep inside for that childhood dream, and set out on a quest for it, their lives would instantly become more meaningful and the dull pain would be replaced with excitement and joy. You got to get crystal clear about your goals and about when you will achieve them. For example, writing, by July 26, I will weigh 195 pounds, works a lot better than writing, I need to lose some weight. See, it's not hard to get specific about your goals. You already do it all the time. Every time you step into your car, I'll bet you know precisely where you're going. You just have a destination in mind. You have purpose. You've just set a specific goal. You don't step into the car thinking, well, I don't know where I'm going. I guess I'll just drive around and see where I wind up. At least I hope you don't. Well, believe it or not, 80% of the people in the U.S. live their whole lives just like that, as aimless wanderers. That's why it's really not hard to become a high achiever. It's just a decision. In 1960, the Harvard Business School did a study of the 1940 graduating class. They found that the top 3% made as much money as the remaining 97% of the class. The only difference between the two groups was this. The top 3% had always written down and regularly read their goals. As a result, everything they did on a day-to-day basis was focused on reaching their goals. You don't have to be a Harvard graduate to make goal setting work for you. All you got to do is decide to do it. Will you? If you will, it'll change your life. Please go to the next CD.